All right. Well, so you grew up in Oklahoma. When did you first start thinking you wanted to become an artist?
15 years old. Mm-hmm. So I've actually been making art since that time. I'm 72 now, so it's quite some time. But I remember the day I decided to be an artist. I'm going to be a painter.
Mm-hmm. What clicked for you about it?
Well, I had taken art classes in high school. I was in high school, and I had an extraordinary teacher, Monty Hoke, who was probably known around this area. He was a wonderful potter. But he encouraged me. He didn't teach me how to paint. He just said, you're going to be a great painter, and here's all your supplies, and here's canvas, and do it. Mm-hmm. And it gave me confidence, you know. And so I'm in the art room one day drawing, and I'm like, I'm going to do this. This is me.
Then you went to, where did you go to art school?
University of Oklahoma.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then what happened after graduation?
Well, I graduated and seemed like within hours I got a draft notice. And I'm like, what? And I was very naive. I didn't know anything about the war. I didn't even know where Vietnam was. I know it sounds odd, but it's the truth. So I got drafted. I was inducted, sent to Fort Polk, Louisiana, where I did basic training. And then I remember the last day of training they were giving at the MOSs, which is Military Occupational Specialties. I'm thinking, I have a college degree, you know, I'm going to be this or that, and Collins, infantry. I'm like, whoa. So a bunch of us, and we all had long faces, were loaded on the back of a truck. The rest were celebrating because they're going to Korea. And we went to this place called Tigerland. It's infamous, you know. There was a movie made of Tigerland. I call him for. So that's where I did advanced infantry training. And the war was really heating up. I mean, at its peak almost. And so they shortened basic training. They shortened AIT by some weeks. And 8 months from art school, I'm in the jungles with a rifle. So it was... It's like a stunning transformation.
Yeah. And at some point, you became a combat artist.
Yes.
What was that? Tell me about that.
Well, I always say that thing saved my life because my infantry unit suffered a lot of casualties. And so I come to Vietnam, and I'm assigned to the 1st Air Cavalry Division, helicopters. My job was rifleman. You know, I'm a grunt in the field. And I remember we were lined up one day, and right before being shipped out to the field, and the company clerk said, is anybody here an artist? Yes, me. And so he comes up to me like this, and he says, remember my face, because they'll probably be calling for you in about a month. They're going to need an artist, and they won't know where to look, but I know where to look. So whatever, I forgot about it. Went out in the field, and we did what grunts do. And then, sure enough, one day somebody said, the captain wants to see you. And the captain's like, you're going in the next chopper. Get on that chopper. And it was so fast, I didn't have a chance to say goodbye to anybody. But I could see them looking like, oh, why not me? Somebody wrote in a book on Vietnam that, I think it was Tim O'Brien, the one obsession of, I think it was him, of a grunt in Vietnam was, how do I get out of the field? And this was like amazing. I did have to take a test of sorts. My friend Chuck Eckberg, who was the company clerk, took me over to meet, this is before I went in the field, took me over to meet these guys in the public information office, which is the newspaper office. And that would have been where I would have been reassigned, perhaps. But I never expected it would come about. But I'm over there and I'm in full combat gear with filthy steel pot grenades hanging off bandoliers, M16. And they said, show us what you can do. And so
No pressure.
So here I am, I don't know what to do. I'm like, so I'm drawing still life with fruit, bananas. So Chuck leans over, they don't want to see that. They want to see a G.I. Joe. So, oh, I can do that. So I got some ink and very quickly did a dog face. And they loved it. So then I'm out in the field for a month, and the captain, they send me back. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, you bond really quick with guys in combat and even jobs in the rear. So it's kind of traumatic being separated so fast. And you feel like, why me? Maybe it shouldn't have been me. It goes on and on. And so I went to my first outfit and nobody would talk to me. I thought they hate me, But the truth is, the reason they weren't talking is one of their guys had been killed recently by a mortar that came in and landed right on top of the guy while I was sleeping. So no place was safe. And they were all in shock still, and they didn't have any desire to talk. But eventually, of course, they did. But I was still, in my mind, I was still an infantryman. And so I got a package together for my infantry squad not long after I got there. Stuff I knew they would like. Like spaghetti and meatballs, sea rations. And pencil and paper, powdered orange juice, stuff like that. And I put it in a box, like a care package, and took it over to the headquarters of the infantry unit, and they would ship these things out every day. So I went over to make sure they got it, and they were just like, I walked in and I knew, this is not good. So they said, didn't you hear what happened? And this is what I did. Did that honestly. But then I turned back and they said, there was this ambush in Hubie and Scotty and two others were killed right away. I knew these guys, they were in my squad. So it was like, I can't describe what it was like. It was devastating, completely devastating. Immediately, you start feeling guilty. Like, I had a hand in this, I should have been there, It's irrational thought that. And I really didn't even know what was happening up here, but I was just out of it for quite some time, and then this realization after a few days came over me, you better start doing your job. Because I was just sitting there at my drawing table, not doing anything. And they left me alone because they knew. But I said to myself, you have to do this job, because if you don't, they're going to send you back. So I just put a lid on it in my head. And the lid stayed on there for many years.
What was the role of the combat illustrator? What did they want you to do?
Well, the combat illustrator is a MOS. It's a specific title. But the reality is, you're a combat artist. You do anything that has to do with a brush. My first job was to change the numbers on Jeeps that had been stolen. I wasn't supposed to say that. I didn't say that.
Didn't hear it.
You just do what you're told to do, you know. Paint a first gap patch on a helmet for the general. But mainly it was to illustrate the stories that the combat journalists had written for Army magazines and newspapers. Periodically I'd have things in the newspapers. People think of the classic combat artist as somebody out on the front lines sketching. Now that's true. I mean, there are some like that, but in most cases, you're back in a base camp at a drawing table doing the work. You might be out there sketching. And I remember the major said to me, we're going to send you out so you can see what it's like out there. And I'm like, I know what it's like out there. And he was like, oh, so, you know. So that's...
When did you pick up the camera?
While I was at Camp Evans, this is where I was stationed. We didn't have anything to do. There was no TV or anything. So everybody had a camera. I didn't have one in the field because you carry everything on your back, and if it's not necessary, you don't take it. Mm-hmm. So I bought a used Nichromat for $50. And I had no idea how to use it. But in addition to combat journalists, I worked with combat photographers who would go out and then come back and go out and come back. And they would help me with the settings. I'd say, I want to do this. They would help me out. So I can't say I ever really learned how to use a camera. I still don't know how. It's just I'm completely right brain. I think I'm not, or I guess it's over there.
But the images are fantastic.
Thank you. I did what most Vietnam vets did, which is you take your pictures, your negatives, your slides. The color ones are all color, were originally color slides. You put them in a box and forget about it, because nobody wants to talk about it. Nobody wants to see these. And I literally had them in a box for 30 years. Never thought about them as art at all. And so eventually, you know, years go by, and I land in Provincetown, Massachusetts, which is a very old art colony. And that's where I've lived for 25 years. I think it was the mid to late 90s. I'm sitting on the post office steps, and there's this woman that I knew she was a photographer. I introduced myself. I've been thinking about these pictures, thinking maybe I will blow some of these up. And you know, exhibition size like these, and show some, just the casual. And she said, great, you know, she was into it. I think her brother-in-law had been a combat soldier in Vietnam. She said, I'll print some up for you. so you see what they look like. So she said, first I have to do contact sheets. Those are the little strips,
yeah,
photographs, so you can see, pick out what you want. So we did those. She brought them over, and I thought, oh, no, these suck. These are bad. And she said, oh, no, these are not bad. These are good. And these are important. And these have, you have to show these. So I'm like, okay. So she printed some up, and as soon as she printed some of these faces, it was like they were there, you know. I was like, wow. You know, and I began, this flood of memories comes back. And so I've had shows of these photographs many times, but I've never had shows of the paintings and photographs together.
How did your painting change? What were you painting in art school?
Who knows? I was, you know, experimenting. I was young, so I painted in a lot of different styles, everything from abstraction to pop art. That's what you do when you're learning, when you're young. But the first painting I painted when I came back from Vietnam, you know, you've seen the illustrations I did. Mm-hmm. I really had to buckle down and teach myself how to draw realistically, which I did. But the first painting was this one right over here, mm-hmm, untitled. I don't know what the title was, never was one. And it's a combination of, I don't know what it is. There's a, that photograph in the painting is from the Battle of Hue, 1968. There's a votive candle, you know, for the dead guys.
Yeah.
Armband from the moratorium. By this time, it's let's get out of there. We don't need to be, we don't want to be there anymore. And the cup, I remember to this day what I felt. This porcelain cup symbolizes how fragile your life is. You know, very fragile cup. And what else is in there? And the red shirt, you know, it's obvious. The blood red shirt. I worked a long time on it, and my friend Don Graham, who I was in Vietnam with, he saw it. He said, I want to buy that. So he did. He bought it. He's had it all these years. Every time I go to his house, he's got it up.
When I walked in, I'd seen some of the photos. I hadn't seen some of the paintings. So when I walked in the gallery for the first time, there's so much emotion coming off. The big one behind me.
Really?
Are you working out?
Yes.
Are you painting still?
About 8 years ago, I started painting about Vietnam again. Mm-hmm. And these are not all of them, but most of them. I can't remember why I started. Yeah, I know why I started. Because I finally started opening up that, taking the lid off of that experience. You know, I remember I shut it down. And I had gone to a therapist because I was just having, I don't know, some troubles. And he asked me one day, tell me about Vietnam. And I'm like, why? Ancient history. And I started telling him about the day that I left the field. You want to still joke? You know, without saying goodbye. And I started to cry. He said, that's okay, we'll come back to this, but we have to talk about this. So it was that day that I think, and also 9/11 when that happened, it did something inside. It was like, oh my God, we're back at war. That feeling like I'm in a war again came over me. The horrible thing. But I think it affected a lot of combat veterans that way. So over the years, this really good therapist who's passed away now, he said, you need to get all the medals and badges that you didn't get that you deserve. I'm like, I don't deserve them. And I had made up these stories in my head that I was unworthy. And a lot of it was survivor guilt, you know, like I'm guilty or something. I had some hand in the death of my friends, but of course I didn't. Then he said, you're going to this reunion of vets. No, I'm not. They hate me. You know, I had built up these crazy stories in my head. So I went. They were wonderful. You know, I'm still in contact with some of them today. This is my infantry outfit. They were like, hey. So it was great. And we tell stories and fill in the blanks. And this book I pointed out to you, Achilles in Vietnam, one of the best books ever written on Vietnam. It's written by a psychiatrist who worked with combat vets, comparing the Trojan War and Achilles and what happened with him when his friend was killed, with these combat vets and what happened with them. It's right down the line the same. And he ended up winning the MacArthur Prize for this kind of work. So I wrote him a letter after I read this book, because in the book were things that, excuse me, in the book were things that, little laryngitis. That I recognized in myself. And I wrote him a letter, and he wrote me right back, a long letter. He said, there's only one way to get over some of this stuff, and it's to find vets and talk to them, ones with the same experience, combat vets, and talk to them because you believe each other. You know, it's impossible for a civilian to understand. And people try. People are wonderful, you know. They look at these and they cry. You know, I guess something comes through.
It does. What do you see when you look at these pictures today?
Well, I see art. That's the other thing. Of course, I have a lot of feelings, and particularly the portraits. They're portraits of guys who were killed, and they're not likenesses. They're ideal portraits, meaning they're a stand-in for the person. This is what the Greeks did when somebody died. They would do a standard sort of statue where they all looked alike. It was a classical ideal. And they would put them up in the cemeteries so they all looked alike. They were individuals, but this was my son. This is my son. This is my son. And so these are sort of conflations of ideal sculpture, expressive painting, and photographic reference all put together. When I look at them, I have all this memory about them. The other paintings, like this big one back here, It's called 1968. And I wanted to express what it felt like to be in a place that was so dangerous. Everything about it was dangerous. And you were on the verge of being killed at all times, and there was no escape. One of the things Jonathan Shea, the author of the book I just mentioned, said, for a Vietnam combat vet, once they were in the field, it was like they were prisoners of the battlefield. There was no escape. So I wanted to remember, you know, take that feeling and make a concrete visual of it. It's the sea, you know, but if you look closely, it looks very threatening.
Yeah.
You know, the ends of the waves are like scorpion tails, or they're like teeth, you know. It's not a fun picture, not a couch picture. Somebody said to me last night, I think they were kidding, I love the colors that... I said, great, put it behind your couch. I think they were joking.
Hopefully. What do you hope audiences get out of not only your show, but the other exhibitions that you're paired with?
Well, there's three exhibitions, and just the fact that the three are shown together is like, I was telling somebody last night, these three could not have happened, you know, many years before. Because it's not like we were enemies necessarily, but the experiences didn't come together. Mm-hmm. That's what I hope people get, is that there's a common ground between them all three of them. Even my own, that are pictures of dead soldiers and that I knew, and places I was. In fact, they came up here to see the show, and they told me they loved it and took a selfie with me.